Welcome to Nerds at Lunch, and our timely, yes, timely, Star Wars discussion. We have all finally seen the movie.
Thanks, Crossco.
Yes.
Okay.
I would do Crossco voice, but I don't think my third.
I've seen the movie twice.
I don't understand a word of it, though. Why is that robot there?
Is that R2? Looks like a smaller R2.
He had the R2 phone. I guarantee you he doesn't know who R2-D2 is.
I think he has an idea.
But... That's my phone, isn't it? That's neat. It's like in the movie.
That's where my phone went all this time.
Steve will be joining us mid-call, ideally. Unfortunately, his wife couldn't make it today. He was going to enlighten us on a Disney employee's experience watching the movie. But I'm sure we'll have her on at some point, because I know we're going to do a Disney episode.
The No Lady Streak continues. Woo!
I'm trying. Trying.
Well, that's not a hard streak to keep up, to tell you what.
It isn't, unfortunately. You'd think we're a bunch of charismatic guys. No, all the girls I know, they don't have mics, and they're expensive people. I would buy them for them. I don't care, but like, mine costs $80. I don't got that kind of cash.
Why don't we all just buy Powerball tickets? Yes. This dates when we actually recorded, people.
If it wasn't a Powerball, there would never be another Nerds at Lunch episode.
It'd be all like IMAX and stuff.
I just buy us a studio. People to think of better names for our podcasts.
Patrick would be recast as Nicolas Cage.
Yes.
He'd do it for free. They're saying, I'm a young black man in Pittsburgh. We put him on his whole life. No, actually, we wanted you to come on as yourself, but no. I'm going to do this.
You would be, you'd be Jeff Goldblum.
That's not fair.
And I could be like Jim Carrey.
No. You're gonna stick me with Goldblum. You're gonna Buscemi.
Marsha.
It's not about you, Jan. It never is.
We're gonna get Star Wars, are we?
Steve would be Danny Trejo.
I love the least accurate casting in this list of Steve is anything other than Steve.
He's about as far from Danny Trejo as you can get.
If you got a young Japanese boy, that would be Steve.
That would be Steve.
Random Japanese kid.
We just use audio clips from Smash of like Ness and Lucas.
Okay.
Today we're going to talk about Smash. Okay. Now we're going to change topics. Whoa!
3 minutes in, we've already wildly veered off what we need. So, we're going to start with impressions of a movie. Spoiler free. Just what we thought about it. And what we liked about the characters. And then, after we've all had our say, we'll go into in-depth discussion. And that'll be spoilers. I'll split it with a break. And, I'll try to let everyone know on timestamp for it on the show notes. But we'll give some warnings before we go into it. If for some reason you haven't seen it, 2 weeks into January, or three by the time this comes out. Okay, so...
It's possible.
I guess.
If Patrick hasn't seen it, then, or hadn't.
He is on the pulse of...
I finally saw it just yesterday. I'm seriously.
I know. That's my fault. I was supposed to take you a week ago, but I got so much crap.
I'm blaming Crossco.
Yeah. So we'll start off with Pat, since you're freshest, obviously.
Oh, yeah. Well, as typical of a new story of Star Wars, it's actually more like character development than anything, but I did like it. So they actually had real emotions in this one, so... I thought it was pretty good. it's hard to do this without actually getting into anything.
Well, That's fine. I understand.
Yeah.
But you can talk about the characters without going over their arcs or anything.
I guess so.
Like, obviously, fan favorite Captain Phasma.
You have to
talk. How's that cup doing, Mark?
I keep pennies in it.
Fun fact, I went to Subway and I got a BB-8 cup. Cost me a buck.
Oh, anyway.
Sure you have a Jar Jar cup somewhere.
I do not. When I wasn't a big episode. Or I wasn't a big Star Wars fan when the prequels came out.
Yeah. Well, anyway, back to what I was saying. You could really tell that J.J. Abrams was directing this movie.
Yeah,
you really could. I do like how they established Finn. That's his name. Yes, that's what he's calling him as a real person instead of just another one of the Well, you get what I'm saying. Yes. Yeah.
And so I think the first stormtrooper. Well, the clone trooper's gone a lot in Clone Wars, obviously.
Yeah.
For the movies, and I think the majority of people, it's the first time we've seen a stormtrooper actually have a unique perspective.
Well, it's because it's not a clone, so that would be why. So
I love how they...
Yeah, all the clones were, you know...
They're all dead.
Yeah, of course they're dead now, but... but the way they did this one... We'll have to do that later.
Well, that's not a spoiler. I think it's important to note because people were bitching about it. The second they found out Finn was a stormtrooper. The bad guys, the First Order in this, they kidnap children and indoctrinate them. make sure they don't, like, go rogue or anything.
It's and, essentially just, like, brainwashing.
Basically.
From a young age.
Yeah. So, that's why Finn is black, everybody. Not because they're clones. or anything like that. It's because they... There was even a lady stormtrooper at some point in the movie. I know that. Not besides Phasma.
They also got to James Bond, too.
Yeah. We'll talk about that scene.
oh, man. I do like how they tie together a lot of the previous storyline to the new one. Yeah. It's obvious as a bridge episode, so.
Not
much else I can say about it, to tell you the truth, but.
Okay.
There was. Well, yeah, they went to a different world, so diverse on that, too.
Yeah, we started off in Jakku and all.
Yeah, you know, another freaking desert planet. Why are all these planets the same all over the whole freaking world? Seriously. Do they not know what seasons are? Climates and differences?
Well, I got the impression that whatever happened on Jakku, it wasn't a desert planet until after that battle.
That's obvious, it seems. There was a lot of stuff there.
just references falling from the sky.
yeah, I wasn't too helpful on that one, but that's pretty much what I felt about the movie.
Okay. Steve will be joining us in a second. I'll add him to the call as soon as he hops on. So, Mark, if you want to go next?
Let's see here. It's been a few weeks, but I definitely liked this movie. definitely felt like what JJ did to this movie was he was given a whole bunch of toys. Yes. And he's like, all right, here you go. You can set up, and he did a really good job setting things up in this movie. He got some nice character interactions, in their scenes and some development going. But you can definitely tell that there's still more that we need to find out about these people. Like, in the case of Finn, he was taken away from his family, so could it be that they'll explore who is his family? Like, watch him be the son of somebody, like, from the old days, or, I don't know, maybe some connection. Plus, everybody wants to know who are the parents of Rey, and so on and so forth with that. I found that the action was pretty well maintained throughout the entire film. Maybe only a little bit seemed a little slow, and that's right after they get off the desert planet, but before they go to the new cantina, where we first meet our somebody from the past again. So that scene with him being introed seemed a little out of place and a little slower. And it almost didn't feel like a Star Wars scene there. But other than that, it definitely had the feels. There was tons of references to the older films there. And a lot of folks are quick to say that, you know, this seems like Episode 4 remastered, but the Episode 4 wasn't broken, so now that they were able to, if that means we can get a 2.0 Empire, then that means that's awesome for Episode 8. Because everybody, I don't know what the mindset is. Has Empire always been championed as, like, the best one?
I think most people believe it's the best one because it got to build on the momentum of the first one, and it got to leave on a cliffhanger, a really good cliffhanger. So it gets all the advantages of being the middle child and none of the problems of having to introduce the world or wrapping up the story.
Mm-hmm. Yes, being the middle child is great.
I mean, it's cool that we got so many of these references. Maybe some of them are a little silly, like the new super weapon.
Yeah.
It's like the fact that they even called out comparing it to the Death Star.
Yeah.
And not so much spoiler because well, that's movie. And well, Han, yeah, that's Han's like, how do we blow this damn thing up? You'd think the Empire would have learned after.
Do you know how many Death Stars there were in the old books before they tossed them all out? A lot. There was one that was just a laser called Darksaber. It didn't get to do anything. It got blown up by asteroids. There was one called the Sun Eater. And there was one called the Sun Killer. There was like 7 rebuilt Death Stars with clone Palpatines. Yeah.
I can just imagine them working on it like a whole bunch of Pikmin.
I have to imagine they used the leftover droids from the Trade Federation to build the Death Stars.
The sun is setting in 3. The ship. But anyway, we definitely had some characters, though, that it would have been nice to see a lot more out of them. I mean, you got some nice development with Finn and Rey and so on, but characters like, as we just joked around, Captain Phasma, she didn't do anything.
You can tell the scene's cut.
Yeah, you can, and we know that she's back for the next one, because, like, we just knew that she's in it, and they got a heck of an explanation, like, to us to how, well, that's going to be talking about the movie more so, it's like, what happens. Like, how the heck can she come back, if you think about it? But, and then I would have loved to have seen a lot more from Poe Dameron. He seemed really cool. And
yeah, we'll get into that in a spoiler discussion, but there's a reason we didn't see a lot of Poe.
Yeah. It seemed like it went by so fast because it just kept the momentum going, barring that one little scene, but it just constantly had, there was like no dragging time at all in this one, it seemed.
Yeah, I honestly, the old movies, they have a lot of, you couldn't do those movies again today. People don't have the patience for them.
For all the backstory and such that we're going to be needing, I think going through, they're going to have to think of a good way to introduce that to us and yet not slow down, like, slog through your movies. Because there's things that we need to know that actually, like, and you just can't assume people that have been reading, like, the new expanded universe that's actually canon now. It's like, oh, okay, this makes sense. But not everybody can or wants to really look at that stuff. Just tell us.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's because of the pacing and such, but was this one of the shorter movies, or?
I think it could have stood to be. It was 2 hours, but yeah, it could have. They could have added an extra 20 minutes, and I don't think anyone would have complained.
Yeah. It definitely, I think it was definitely one of the stronger openings, too, of any of the.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Actually seeing their, like, action stuff's getting done, and the introducing the big bad was really good. The fact of what he can do, that's, it's like, ooh. On the whole, though, I was happy to see it. I would like to see it again, but I'll be content when it comes out on DVD and Blu-ray and all that jazz, so that way I can just pause and look at scenes, and that way you can see all, like, let's see, what was it? I think you got to see this weird character on, like, a magazine. He was supposed to be on Jakku and stuff, and they were advertising him. In fact, he's on this, like, one film makeup magazine now, costuming. The guy is, like, I don't think in the movie at all. And there's even a toy for him, too. And it turns out those were, like, sent off to, like, Hasbro early, before they were all finished and stuff. So, if anybody has, I don't know who this guy is. It's like a captain or a commander or something. It's an alien guy. It looks like he's wearing, like, something over his face, and it's, like, bluish and stuff. But, yeah. If you thought that character and you haven't seen it yet, it's going to be pretty impactful. Sure. That character's really Kylo Ren, I'm sorry. But, as I guess, a few words or less, definitely a great starting film. Definitely sets up a heck of an episode 8 and 9. So, and the fact that it's like episode 4 is no crime.
Yeah. I think it needed to be like episode 4, honestly.
So, hey, did you see my message there?
Oh, cool. Chris the Cat actually joined us today.
Oh so, my god. That's cool. Get out of the dress. We don't need that.
I don't know. I think Auntie Patricia could give us some down wisdom.
Not to be like that, but it'd be like Tyler Perry. Medea review Star Wars.
Okay, cool. That's cool. Well, if you
hey,
want to
no
give your
Lord's in here, is it?
Chrissy, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay, well, no one says that. So, Mark had just finished his impressions. We probably this might be a sudden edit for anyone listening. Steve and his wife Krista have just joined us. So we were just doing impressions, guys. Krista, if you want to go first, since you had a more unique experience than the rest of us, since you're a Disney employee.
Yeah, I mean, I really liked the movie, obviously. You know, there were just things about the Death Star and things like that, but more what I was going to talk about, you know, just things going on around Disney, because they're coming up with the whole Star Wars land, which I'm sure you guys have heard about. In Hollywood Studios, you're seeing a lot of that transformation going on right now. So, you know, for the movie experience, you know, they just kind of, basically we got time off of work and they're around 1 o'clock or whatever, and they're like, oh, you can go see the movie. So we all got an afternoon off of work to go see the movie, and they gave us, you know, pins, and we could buy, like, sweatshirts and, you know, cast-exclusive stuff like that. Yeah. So that was kind of cool. And then, you know, we just kind of got to all nerd out together because it was a bunch of technology people, you know, so every one of them was into Star Wars. So we just, you know, kind of nerded out for, like, 3 hours or whatever the movie length was. And, you know, it was just kind of cool, and it was a neat bonding experience to, you know, get to know my coworkers a little better. And some of the other things going around Disney, though, was, I guess if you saw it the night that it premiered at midnight, they had a special rock and roller coaster.
Oh, we lost her.
Okay, I'm back. Okay. Sorry about that. So anyway, I was saying, they did a special, if you saw, I don't know if it was the whole day or just at midnight, but they were somehow able to gather all the people that were there at Disney Springs to see the movie, and they gave them a special ride on the rock and roller coaster to Star Wars music instead of Aerosmith.
Oh, wow.
My speculation is on that they're probably going to completely design that whole ride. It'll probably be the same base ride, but they're probably going to retheme it to Star Wars, is my guess, eventually. What else is going on? I know that, obviously, in Hollywood Studios, they redid all the animation exhibit. I don't know if you guys ever been to Hollywood Studios or not, but they used to have a tour where you could like watch the animators animate the next feature that was coming. And they, I mean, the animation building behind the park is still there and the employees are still there, but you can't, you know, see the employees and doing what they're doing. And they, but they redid it with this launch bay exhibit. So basically now it's a whole tour and you can go through, it's like a walking, I don't even know how long it takes, probably 10 minutes, but supposedly they have all kinds of memorabilia from like the original Star Wars films in that exhibit. So just kind of different things. And then of course they got Star Tours and they have the new scenes from the new film in that. So I guess we'll see what else they have in store. That's pretty much all that's changed right now at Hollywood Studios. But I'm sure that there's more coming down the, in the next couple years. I don't think it's supposed to be done until next year at some point.
Yeah, I would imagine, they'll start announcing like the big stuff to the public soon.
Yeah, I mean, I love Star Wars and everything. The only thing I just hope that they don't rip out the Muppets. It's the only thing I'm fine with. Everything else can go. Just leave my Muppets alone.
Yeah, I like the Muppets too. I'm hoping they'll stick around.
I'm fine with everything else. Just they did start a new parade, and they have, at least in Disneyland, I don't know about here in Florida, but have Kylo Ren and some of the other Star Wars characters as part of the, some of the parades as well. So,
that's neat. Yeah. So, do the Star? I know some mascots aren't allowed to talk. Are the Star Wars characters allowed to? Or
no, they're not, because they can't. Because Disney is so, they're very anal about this that they have to be. They have to be the exact character, and since you can't emulate James Earl Jones's voice, for example, or you know, Baca's voice, that they're not allowed to talk for that reason.
That makes sense.
Yeah, because they have to be the character, and you have to think that they're the character.
Hopefully I'll get down there someday. We all want to go, but
yes, I do. For I can get three additional guests in, plus me and Steve, if you guys ever do come in. So and you guys can come in completely for free with me. So
we're trying to wait until the Nintendo stuff is announced, so we can.
Oh, I know.
Big week of it or something.
I know that. As far as I know, they haven't broken any ground on that. Because actually, where I'm at right now, they moved us because all the Hollywood Studios stuff going on. They moved us across from Universal. And I haven't seen too much construction going on yet. But,
well, from what I've read, the popular theory is they're going to get rid of, like, Toon Lagoon or something like that.
Yeah, that's kind of what I heard, too. I don't know if they bought it, but there is also rumor that they were either acquiring land or have acquired land. I don't know what the status of all that is.
I know Pat and I talked about this. I'm sure I did a lot of research on it at the time. I'll have to put that episode in the show notes for anyone who's interested on the Universal Nintendo deal. I'm pretty sure they did buy some land. I'm not sure what, though.
Yeah. I don't know. I also heard rumor that the Wet n Wild, which is the one water park nearby that they acquired, and were supposedly going to do something with that. But and
isn't it's the abandoned one?
Yeah. And I guess it's officially acquired by them, and I guess there's plans to demolish it. So my guess is part of that will probably be Nintendo Land eventually.
Well, thank you for coming on, Krista. I don't know if you want to stick around or if you and Steve.
We're kind of sharing headsets right now, because I'll give the headset back to him for now. And
okay. If you have anything you want to say, just chime in.
Okay, I'm back.
Okay, so Steve, you're unique in that you've literally never seen Star Wars before.
Well, I mean, I did watch the original three movies when I was a little kid, but I guess they just didn't really make an impression on me, so I you know, I never really went
well, Steve,
much
this
more
is so
than
redundant
that.
Kurosawa's work. No, I'm kidding. But you're basically a Star Wars, I guess, newcomer. So
yeah, I mean, that's how I kind of at least feel that I fit in with that type of title, I guess.
So I'm actually interested in what you thought of the movie.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, I mean, I did, maybe sometime last, it's probably been even longer. It was probably about 2 years ago, maybe, that I did rewatch the original three after, like I said, watching them when I was a little kid. And, I just think it's because of, you know, today's technology and everything that I'm sure if I was watching them back when they were initially out, that it would have been more exciting, but, you know, I guess it just doesn't have, it loses a sort of an appeal since I didn't watch it really back then, or at least remember much of it. So, you know, I mean, they weren't bad, but I didn't think they were anything amazing, I guess. And then I eventually wanted to watch, you know, just because of this new movie, the prequel movies, which everyone always told me, don't even bother, it's a waste of your time. And, you know, I figured, like, there was this one guy that I talked to a while ago that, he just randomly started a conversation with me that he was saying that he liked the prequel movies better than the original three. So I was like, you know, I should probably just give these a shot. And then I was really regretting my decision after the first one. And I was like, maybe it'll get better. And it just never really did.
They're not just bad Star Wars movies. They're just badly put together movies.
Yeah, I mean, that was my problem, is just the and it wasn't really, I don't think it's the actor's fault. It's just like, but I feel like the acting and the writing were just really not good at all. And, you know, it just, I feel like that they were just doing their best with the scripts they were given. But I just, yeah, I don't think that they did a good job writing that. And I know I read all this stuff about it just having to do with people not wanting to say no to George Lucas and whatnot.
Yeah, that was the point where he was considered some sort of directorial god and no one wanted to question him.
And then, you know, it's still, I still wanted to see the new one, and I just really, I mean, from my watching the movies, and then I did, after watching the prequels, watch the original three again and saw all kinds of story issues that didn't sync. So I feel like that they weren't even thinking about it when they made the prequel movies, that some things weren't going to fit in right.
And I brought that up in our preview episode. Yeah, there's a lot of problems. Notably, Jimmy Smits, who is really an important character in Star Wars lore, Leia's father, adopted father, is only in the last movie for like 15 minutes.
it didn't really have been
in all three, but
my mother died when we were really young. Really, 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 really
Yeah.
So, you know, but I mean, all of the issues aside, I mean, like I said, I didn't think that the original three were bad. Like I said, it just that I guess it was just a matter of that comparing it to stuff I've seen more recently and then watching them, it wasn't, you know, as impressionable. But, you know, I really liked the Star Wars universe, so that's why I just was hoping that with a brand new movie that, you know, it would be kind of more what I was expecting. And, you know, I just, as soon as the movie started, I mean, just the entire way through, I just was sitting there just like probably smiling the whole time. I was like, wow, this is so great. I mean, it's everything I expected it to be for, you know, what a today's movie would be like. And, yeah, you know, I felt like that all the characters were really interesting. You know, I felt before that a lot of the characters just kind of bored me. You know, it was the way that the story, the flow of the movie just, you know, there was no boring parts to me. Like, I felt like there was a lot of parts that could have been completely cut out from all of the previous movies. So, you know, this one didn't feel like it was just trying to drag it or anything. So, and like I said, the characters, and especially Kylo Ren, I mean, he was pretty entertaining at some of those parts where he was going nuts. But I mean, it's more like, I feel like there's so much to his character that, you know, it's actually really interesting. We don't know about the Knights of Ren yet, and, you know, there all this other backstory with him. And I was reading something just recently, too, where they were talking about how newcomer...
Oh, wait, we're going to do spoilers after the break.
So, Eve, you almost let it slip that he was Jar Jar. I mean, how could you?
He got beat by Wicket and
the Ewoks are all dead.
You can go ahead and just cut that part, then.
I'll
bring it back up later when we talk about stuff.
That's my fault. I should have mentioned...
Whenever Steve would start saying that, you can just edit in like a big henshin.
So, anything else you want to say about it, Steve?
I mean, the only other thing that is just saying, I've probably mentioned it a bunch of times on everywhere that I've talked about it, but just the fact that, you know, with these movies, I was able to just watch them all in one go. It's like, all right, let's finish this whole trilogy. But it sucks now being part of the, you know, like up to date with everything and having to wait now until, what is it going to be, like May 2017, I think it said?
No. Actually, there's going to be a Star Wars movie in May. And then, it won't be as long as the wait as normal. But yeah, it'll still be May 2017, but we'll have a movie in between about the Death Star, apparently.
Oh, so I didn't even know. I know that I saw that there was supposed to be a Han Solo movie and a Boba Fett movie, but those looked like they were later. Boba Fett's in like 2020.
So you won't actually go that very long without Star Wars content. Just the main storyline movies will still be spaced apart pretty far. You can watch Rebels.
Oh yeah, I know there's all kinds of those like TV shows and stuff.
But yeah, we might do an episode for Rogue One if they ever release a trailer. They don't want to for obvious reasons, but hopefully we'll get one in the next month or so. It comes out in 4 months.
Don't worry, there's nerds everywhere working on getting that content to you.
Sweet, sweet X-Wing action.
I don't think there's any X-Wings in it. It's supposed to be about the Bakh and Spy Network. They got the Death Star plans.
Oh, but they just died to give us that information. That's all we need to know.
Okay. That was one thing that kind of bothered me with the original movies, is that assuming you take the prequels into account, so I mean, really, I guess it's not the original movies, but the prequels, that, you know, if it took them, like, what is it, like 20 years to build that first Death Star, and then all of a sudden they built that second one, and like Return of the Jedi super quick.
Yeah, they built it in at least 5 years, given this gap between the movie, but
they took the space Kickstarter.
By the time Jedi came out, Lucas was all about the spectacle, and he felt he needed a Death Star to up the odds. But it could have just been an Empire moon base building something.
I read something too. I don't know how true it was, but they were saying that George Lucas had said that one of the things that he wasn't too happy with the new movie was that there was just a lot of mirroring of, you know, like, I guess the original movies. And he was saying that he liked to bring something new to each movie, but then it's like, then why did he bring the Death Star back again?
Yeah, exactly. He's kind of him. He also called Disney white slavers in that interview. So, I'm not sure how much we can take from that. They like made him apologize. Like Disney's like, whoa, listen, buddy, we give you a
$4 billion check.
Yeah, you're gonna take that.
He's just mad that there's not enough poetry and rhyming. They even know there's tons of it in this new one.
So, before we go to the spoiler discussion, I'm going to give my impressions. Bear with me, I have a sore throat today. So, I know it's unheard of, but I saw the movie twice.
What?
I know.
Krista saw it twice, too.
I was supposed to go with my brother, but I think anyone who knows my brother knows that ended poorly. But I went by myself, got stuck next to an old dude. This was my second time. But and he slept the whole movie. And his wife kept waking him up, and he would wake up in the most stereotypical old guy way ever. He'd go, "Whoa, what? What?" Like, oh my god.
Sputterings and flatulence.
I'm like, dude, why are you even here? And like, I don't want to punch a 50-year-old man, but... I'm like, listen, I was there to try to get a better grasp on the stuff I, because when I saw it with Mark, The whole movie, I'm like, I wonder when Luke's scene is, or I wonder when this is going to happen. Because I knew Luke was in it, and I knew to expect certain story beats. But I still enjoyed the movie, but I wanted to go in a second time and not expect anything. I just wanted to watch it and enjoy it for what it was. And, I mean, that guy aside, it wasn't that bad. I really like Finn. Mm-hmm. I think we can all agree Star Wars characters tend to be a little stiff. Finn and Rey and even Poe, from the little time he's on the screen, they're really energetic. Like, you believe these guys are young people who have just found themselves in a fantastic situation.
Yeah, I think that's kind of what I was trying to get at, too, what I was mentioning, is that I felt like the characters were a lot more interesting in this one.
You get a little of that from Mark Hamill, because he's...
I mean, I think in the first one, he was kind of a little boring to me, but you could tell he kind of grew as the movies continued.
Yeah. But, I mean, and I don't mind Han being a little bored, because he's a skeptical dude. He doesn't believe in anything. First movie. True.
All of it.
I didn't have a problem with that. When we get into the spoilers, I'll talk about Han's arc maybe. But so I like the I consider Poe lead because he's probably going to be a big factor in the next three movies.
No way.
Oh, I think so. I like even. I hope the traitor thing with Finn. Like, it's not really a spoiler. But I just hope every movie has, like, a stormtrooper or somebody run up to them and yell, traitor.
Traitor!
That was so funny.
I kind of want to see that, too.
Apparently he does have an official name, and, like, Luke, like, Disney actually gave him a slight...
Oh, no, I read that, too. That's not an official Disney product, apparently.
Apparently people think he's a Pokemon because they dubbed him Trey Ater. It's his code name.
He does need a last name eventually, though. Like, he's the only Star Wars character with one name.
Oh, that's pretty obvious as to why.
Well, yeah, but I'm sure I'll get it.
What about Maz?
I'm just going to call it here because it's not a spoiler. He's not Lando's son.
No.
That's stupid. And that would actually really hurt the character, in my opinion.
Yeah, I heard people talking about that, and it just didn't seem like... I feel like that would just be really trying to push it with, you know... It's like, oh, all these people are related to the original characters.
Yeah. Like, they could just be people who just never met before.
Yeah. Also, let's be honest. If the Empire took Lando's kid, Lando's going to get his kid back.
Yeah, obviously.
Yeah.
Like, this is the dude who went against Vader to save his city. He's not going to be like, oh, they took my kid. Well, woe is me.
And his age wouldn't be right if I heard a theory that thought that maybe he
Yeah, because Lando's like in his 40s in Empire.
Yeah.
So, like, if he had a kid Finn's age, he would have been like 50 or 60.
Which isn't unheard of, but not very likely.
Yeah. That Finn's also... only in his 20s.
And anybody, like, stop that moronic theory that he's Mace Windu's. No, that's even...
I hate that nonsense, too. Mace Windu wouldn't have a son because he was a damn Jedi.
Man, there's two black characters in the Star Wars canon. Who could
they, have been Mace Windu? One of them. Oh, no, they're all three of them are related, Pat.
There are no other black people in the entire galaxy, just those three.
Although the Finn family was before they were murdered by the stormtroopers. There was at least two other ones.
Okay, folks. So it turns out he's really Jar Jar's son, okay?
Yeah.
He's Han's son. Han just, you know, he wandered the galaxy for a while before he married Leia. Oh, no, okay. We're going way off.
Alright, that's enough.
Yeah. I didn't like the scene where he went to his Aunt Medea and got some advice about the Force. Being a jerk. I like the character beats. I'm going to go to Rey real fast. The weird complaints about her being a Mary Sue don't work for me. Because she's not a Mary Sue. They explain in the movie everything she does. And if you don't pay attention to the film, that's your problem. But, like, there's actual dialogue referencing how she acts. Yeah, I'm not going to go into details yet, but... I really liked Rey. I'm glad she's the lead. I'm glad I have a Star Wars movie I can show to my niece. I'm not happy that Rey has a bow stick that I'm sure I'm going to get hit with repeatedly by my nieces. But
I'm actually not happy about that. So.
But we'll see. We'll see. I wasn't a fan of her outfit. I mean, it makes sense for a desert world. I think they could have changed her outfit at some point. Especially since most of the movie she's hanging out with Han. I would have thought it would have been cool if she got like his old outfit, because he's wearing a different vest in this movie.
Everybody just steals each other's clothes. Finn steals clothes. There's no
clothing stores in Star Wars.
Every place they walk into is just another cantina.
Like Luke, no one knows where Luke got his cloak from Return of the Jedi. He was wearing the same outfit for 3 years.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're going to take a break. And when we come back, we're going to go into spoilers. So we will see you in a minute. And we're back. Pat's got to leave, so he's just going to talk a little bit about the spoilers he wants to cover. And then we're just going to do probably a small spoiler discussion. So, Pat?
Yeah, you know what? Matt Crosco can go suck a freaking... Anyway.
Let me tell you something.
Of course he did. You know it's Matt Crosco. He's a bastard.
He told you about Han, didn't he?
Huh?
He told you about Han, didn't he?
Of course he did. He's Matt Crosco. Well, I had a feeling before I went to go see the movie in the first place that somebody was going to die, and obviously he told me who, just right out of the blue, because he's Matt Crosco. Yeah, anyway, he knew I hadn't seen the movie and that I was going to see it soon. Anyway, let me get back to where I was at. Okay. I guess... dang it.
You want to start with, like, is the death or Kylo Ren's identity?
That was pretty much tied into each other. Mm. I just like Finn's character altogether. Because I really like how the character of the guy that the actor who plays Finn is nothing like him whatsoever. he's like a completely different guy from what he plays. But Yeah, the pilot, Poe, was
Poe Dameron.
Yeah. They had him early on. Yeah, Jason, you're right. They didn't have that guy in that freaking movie that long at all.
Well, he was supposed to die.
Yeah, I know that, but it's like...
And then Abrams is like, why the hell would I waste this character? He has chemistry with everyone.
Yeah.
So, they brought him back.
Good. I'm glad he did. So, well, I guess the biggest thing I saw about the movie was the fact that they built a freaking death weapon out of a planet. An entire freaking planet. I don't know what the Empire's obsession with death weapon is, or the dark side of the Force in general, because it's not necessarily Empire, because that's gone. It's the First Order.
Well, the First Order, from what I understand, isn't allowed to have a battleship fleet, because treaty with the Republic.
Yeah.
So they built the one Star Destroyer we see, they built that in secret, apparently.
Uh-huh.
And they carved that planet into a Death Star.
that was the first thing I was thinking when I saw that. I'm like, they made another freaking Death Star out of this planet, didn't they? And then they shot the freaking giant laser. Like, well, so much for those guys. So they blew up 4 Republic planets at the same time.
Yeah. They cover this in one of the, fact books or something, but the Republic Senate moves every 5 years or something. Mm-hmm. Specifically, so if there was no Death Star, destroying it wouldn't hurt them as badly.
Right.
So this didn't destroy the Republic. I'm sure they'll cover that in the next movie. But
I'm certain of that, too. It's just probably wiped out quite a bit of the people who were in, so.
Oh, yeah. No.
I'm sure Luke felt that one.
That's probably why he was standing there looking.
Yeah.
Black at the Force.
And now that I've seen the movie, I kind of appreciate the memes about, Evo Kylo Ren and all that stuff, too, which I find really funny. Basically, that was another permeating theme about the movie, is that Kylo really, really is obsessed with his grandfather, and the dark side of whatever, Snoke, his name? Yeah.
Snoke, yeah.
He really took advantage of that to try to get him towards the dark side. Mm-hmm. But he's still, fighting himself within. That's going to be another interesting development they have on that. But
well, that's why Snoke wanted him to kill Han.
Right, yeah.
So that he wouldn't have any more attachments.
But he still does.
Yeah. Hey, still got his mom.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's going to be interesting. I was like, man, they really did manipulate this guy pretty bad. Because he just goes off the deep end a lot. Another funny part of the movie when he freaking sees that Rey has escaped from her restraints and he starts flipping out. Yeah. And the stormtroopers
are like, wait, wait.
The other way.
Yeah, let's go around this.
That was definitely one of the funniest parts of this. They're just like, yeah, we better come back later.
I really enjoyed how funny this movie
is. Yeah. And I do like how they still have that dynamic between a general and a Sith Lord. Between
Hux and Ren.
Yeah. Like they did in the fourth
one. Yeah. That's one of the mistakes I think he made, is killing off Tarkin.
Yeah.
You heard a deer, don't worry about it.
Well, overall, yeah, this is this is pretty much what I expected from a introductory trilogy movie, if you know what I mean. That's usually what they do with movies like this, except for this was a lot more fast-paced than I expected.
Yeah.
Which was really, great. Good thing we live in this early age like we do with the special effects and such, too. Yeah. That really helps you get your point across a lot faster. Plus, it doesn't take as long to film movies as it would.
That is a good thing. We don't really have to wait as long.
Yeah, how long did it take between the two movies way back then? It was 4 years, right?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, my God. I can't imagine that. I'm just rambling along. But, characters of Rey, Finn, Oh, they're obviously going to be main characters for some time to come.
Yeah.
Their interaction between droids and other creatures and how they feel that they are. Finn's choice to, like, not murder those people in that village.
Yeah. I think that's going to be important later. Some people think maybe the Force made him do it.
Uh-huh.
I don't think he's Force, like, I don't think he's going to be a Jedi. But...
No, I don't think so either.
I love how on Facebook, a guy on a Star Wars post is like, how can Finn use a lightsaber? It's like, you know,
oh, there's this dumb thing from the old books. That only Jedi can use lightsabers because lightsabers have a gyroscope or some nonsense in them. But that doesn't make sense either because that's not what gyroscopes do, but they tilt wildly. And you need the Force to guide it.
Plus, Han used
it. Han used
it. I'm sure that it takes, like, a lot of, you know, practice.
He used it pretty efficiently. Like, you're not going to block blaster bolts with it.
But... Oh, no, he's not going to do that. But he did run through a lot of people. That was pretty fun. The traitor part was
traitor.
That was so funny. This is meant to be a funny thing.
It seems like once they got to that cantina place, they kind of try to force stuff through that a little bit faster. But that I don't really consider that a complaint too much, because lots of things were happening at the same time.
Yeah.
So it seemed like they were trying to create that air of confusion, where you could tell that the tide was beginning to turn. So, overall, I did love the movie. Can't wait till the next one comes out. I'm not really going to be one of those guys who's going to criticize anything about it, because I really didn't have anything to complain about the movie.
I have criticisms, but nothing important.
Right, yeah, it's not like I'm going to be comic book guy, like, worst sequel ever, you know?
Worst sequel that's a prequel of a sub-sequel.
There are people who are flipping out because they saw the laser being fired from the cantina planet. They're annoyed that that's not how hyperspace works. I don't care how hyperspace works.
Who cares what physics does? It's cool, isn't it?
Family Guy actually had a clip on the last episode. They had a clip. He was talking about Shawshank Redemption poster. He's like, one question. How did you get that poster so taut from behind?
Yeah.
He's like, does that really matter? To me, it does. He's like, do you even like this movie? Up until that point. Like, oh, it could have just been a Star Wars joke. That's, people are legit mad about the laser. I'm like, who cares? It was...
Did I not realize that this is a work of fiction? Yeah. I mean... It's a story, is it not?
They get mad about that in the Star Trek movie. When Spock sees Vulcan being destroyed.
And
he time.
Yeah.
The planet he's on. Who cares?
Was Vulcan close enough to see him in the daytime?
That was why Nero left him on the planet, so I assume so.
Yeah, so, yeah. I'm getting off topic. I'm just rambling because I gotta get ready to get out of here. Yeah.
That's fine, Pat. If you gotta go, we're probably not gonna be much longer here. We're just
There's one other thing about that planet that they were on, Jakku.
Yeah.
Another character I really liked was the guy who was like the dealer for the scrap stuff that she was turning in.
That was Simon Pegg.
Yeah.
60 portions.
Oh, yeah. And then this guy, God damn it, why can't I talk? Okay. Another thing, that there's a lot of people around who still sympathetic to the First Order in the entire galaxy, evidently. So, I found that really weird. There's spies everywhere.
Most likely for money.
Yeah, that's obvious. Because, you know, evidently...
They want those sweet, sweet instant cupcake packets.
Sweet bread.
I found it funny that the piece of junk that she didn't want to fly was the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah.
I had a feeling it was that, but I was like, yeah, there it is right there. Then the guy complains that it was,
his ship.
Yeah. like she has a really, I do like how Ray has a really good knowledge of how ships are supposed to work, and she was really mad about him adding the compressor.
Yeah, well, I like the reason she was so familiar with the Falcon is because he made her fix it.
Yes.
That's something, at least. That's another thing people brought up. How could she fly the Falcon so well? Because the dude who basically owns her made her fix it?
Yeah. I mean, if she's been a scavenger for scrap this whole time, I'm sure she has some sort of knowledge of
what she's doing. Yeah, I know how a ship works.
Right. So it's not too far-fetched. Kylo Ren. Beats the crap out of this freaking console. I just remember that picture that Steve put on there with the Tycho drums.
Tycho drums, yeah.
I like that it happens so often that people they hear it.
Yeah, he's really taking advantage of that poor kid. Yeah. So. It seems like it's going on a familiar tangent, but we'll figure that out later on. That's pretty much what I had to do about that one, so I'm going to get up and out of here.
Okay,
I'm not the ram of that one, but
maybe we'll
discuss it another time.
Okay.
I'll see you guys later.
Okay, Pat, see ya. So Pat covered a few of the bases. Is there anything else you guys wanted to talk about? I don't see.
I thought he was mentioning kind of with the special effects and stuff too. I mean, I feel like they definitely made the battles way more intense. There was stormtroopers flying through the air and all kinds of. Like, it was pretty fun. I just thought, yeah, they did a good job with that, and it was kind of neat too. I kind of feel that the way that they kind of portrayed the First Order versus with the kind of Imperial stormtroopers, like, I don't know, I just felt like they seemed a lot more threatening since they were just kind of getting stuff done. You know, it was like, let's just kill them all. Like, before it was like you have these stormtroopers like search the ship and capture the prisoners, like, so they're just like kill them all.
Yeah. I think that was one of their things, is they definitely wanted to make stormtroopers more threatening.
They actually hit stuff.
Yes.
I like that that whole armament that one stormtrooper had with the shield and that one weapon. They actually have, it's like one of those, the figure arts for the stormtroopers. They have, it's a limited edition one that comes with those, that equipment.
The shock stick, I think they called it. I think that's the official name. I like the idea that they know they're going to be fighting Jedi at some point. So they trained stormtroopers to have anti-lightsaber weapons. It's fantastic.
Yeah. I'm kind of disappointed, and I heard, I forget who brought this up, and it was like some other cast, but I can't help but feel that it would have been more fitting, I think, if maybe Finn would have actually tried to have fought Phasma there on that planet. Like, she would actually be the one with the shock stick. It just seemed like they wanted to, at the beginning of the movie, it's like she gets on his case. It's like, why did you take off your helmet and stuff? Like, they maybe really wanted to make her his antagonist. And it's just this random, now famous stormtrooper.
Like I said, I think they dropped the whole plot in there. They had to. They had to be more of Phasma and Finn.
Like, they capture her at the Star Killer base to take down the shields, and then they episode four her into a trash compactor, evidently. But we gotta remember, the planet then blew up, so if she's supposed to be in the next movie, she had to have gotten out or something.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Well, I was reading that they said that Harrison Ford was, like, cast for the next movie, so I don't know if he's just supposed to be in flashbacks or if he somehow, I don't know how he would have escaped that.
Oh no, he's definitely dead. I think
he'll be a ghost, like not a Force ghost, but I don't know.
I could see flashbacks or something, but I don't think he's going to be in it that much, to be honest.
I didn't even expect it. I assumed from the beginning that after I heard that he got injured on set during the filming of that, that he was probably not going to be in anymore, so I figured they were just going to kill him off.
Yeah.
And in that scene, like, when he's trying to get the lightsaber from Kylo, it's like, you don't get a lightsaber from a Jedi, usually willingly.
I know. Or Sith.
Yes. You just don't like
his work.
Yep. What I was saying before when I kind of was like saying the spoiler stuff, I was reading about someone was kind of bringing up the point that, you know, Chewbacca with that crossbow thing, I mean, he was blasting the crap out of everything, and, you know, he shoots Kylo Ren, and all, you know, he just stands up afterwards, and, yeah, you know, it's like, obviously he can take a hit.
Well, I assume he was using the Force at that point to try to keep himself together. There's no way.
Yeah, I mean, that's what they were kind of getting at. They were saying that he has such strong control with the Force that he was able to, you know, just stand up afterwards and fight them.
He had to get his own adrenaline going by beating the wound.
It didn't work out for him, though.
No. It was a pretty good duel between Kylo and those two.
That's another thing, too, that I really liked in this movie versus, especially not in the, just the way that the fights were, they just felt, it felt more like a real action scene versus, I just, especially in the prequel movies, hated that they did all this crazy special effect jumping around and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, it was fine for, like, Yoda, for example. I mean, he was the CG character anyway on the screen, but it just felt really awkward for the actual people to be doing it.
It looked more like a real fight versus a choreography fight. Capoeira.
Yeah, that was one of my things with the prequels, is they were over choreographed. And, I mean, that's not how Jedi's are supposed to fight. They're very deliberate, because they're letting the Force decide for them where they're going to strike. So, I don't know. I like that these fights were still really brutal and fast paced, but they weren't like crazy ninja foot battles.
Mm-hmm. We'll be due for getting probably a lot more as we move forward, because...
Yeah, because I think we're probably going to see the Knights of Ren in the second movie, because Kylo's not going to be at full power.
Yeah, and Snoke's going to be like, ah, crap, they found Luke, so here comes some more Jedi.
Yeah.
They're probably in Episode 8, like, once Luke's debriefed and maybe trained Rey some more, he's probably like, okay, I think Rey was originally part of the Academy, but like they, like you said, maybe they forced her to forget and they threw her on Jakku so that she'd be safe from like Kylo.
That's right. Some people are like, oh, it's Kylo's sister. Like, I think he'd recognize his sister.
Yeah.
Plus, I think Han would say something if he found his daughter, too.
I do feel like that. I don't know if maybe I was just kind of reading it wrong, but I kind of felt like it seemed as if Kylo at least had an idea who Rey was. So, I mean, that makes it make more sense that maybe she was there with Luke and them training.
I'm sure if there was one girl he missed in the slaughter, that would haunt him. And, just some miracle chick out of nowhere doing all this stuff probably piqued his interest.
Mm-hmm.
Han seemed to know something about her. Or at least saw something in her that he trusted. So, but I'm sure we'll cover this. Probably the beginning of the first movie. I don't...
And Luke will probably... Maybe she won't be the only one that they managed to hide away. I mean, they implied that Kylo had, like, killed a lot of them, but maybe...
Yeah, at least he killed all the adults in training. I don't know if Luke would take on children. Maybe he did, and maybe he managed to save a couple of them.
And that could be a thing for F8 is like Rey and company to go find all these Jedi in hiding and such.
Makes you wonder why the Republic didn't have like an army guarding this small Jedi order that was clearly important. I guess we'll see. I think that's a little weird.
Hopefully they've learned now, though, that if you have the Skywalker genes in you, you should not reproduce in case you get another Vader.
Well, people are saying she might be Obi-Wan's, like, relative, and I think that's even stupider.
It's like, if there's one character that she has to be associated with, like, it would have to be most likely Luke here.
Yeah, like, Obi-Wan, they're like, well, Obi-Wan was on that desert for 20 years. I'm like, he saw what happened when you get married as a Jedi. and have emotional attachments to other people. He's not going to go and find a chick and have a kid.
Luke and Anakin were both good pilots, and Anakin liked to tinker with machinery as well as Luke.
I think if she is his daughter, he's not aware of it.
Another force-conceived child?
No, like, whoever his wife was, she took the kid and vanished.
Hmm.
Probably because of Kylo. She'd be about the right age.
Looking at the art book before it had come out, and I kept quiet on this because I was waiting to see this in the movie, but it was evidently cut, like, according to one, I guess, maybe it's from the book, but we were actually supposed to see, I think, Anakin in this movie.
Huh.
Luke, there must have been a scene with Luke where he actually does see the Force ghost of Anakin, and it actually... In the concept art, you can see here, you can see good Anakin Skywalker, and then just like a transformation as he actually turns into Vader. Like at one point, it's like half the mask is on him and half isn't. So, but that could be stuff that they could be putting in the next movie. But I was like, oh wait, it's not here.
Well, yeah, that's concept art now. That's not always a guarantee.
Yeah, most of the book was accurate-ish. Otherwise, the Luke stuff was like, no.
I think they had bigger plans for Luke, and then they decided that it had to be about the new characters more than the old ones.
Yeah.
That's why we got what we did.
I have to steal a joke I heard from Brain Scratch's review, or discussion on the movie, and it's like, after the table reading of The Force Awakens, Mark Hamill takes JJ aside and says, "Can I have a word?"
I'm just really busy with this trickster stuff. And, I mean, it's network TV, CW. That's really big. So, if you could just cut my scenes down, like, right at the end, I would appreciate it.
And there's stuff we need to, like, find out. Like, how did Maz get the lightsaber in her basement?
I guarantee it's going to be, like, an afterthought thing in a book.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, Lando gave it to her as he was, like, scrubbing up Cloud City after Empire.
How did Kylo indeed get the mask?
You know what? Kylo knows what the lightsaber looks like, so that's something else entirely. How would he know what it looks like?
Yeah. And how would... Did Luke take the helmet from Endor? Did Kylo go to Endor eventually and it was still there? Or did it's like... I think books had said maybe some bandits or something maybe pillaged it and he got it from them or something? I don't know.
I'm sure they'll explain some of this.
And how tall is Snoke?
Snoke is apparently 7 feet tall. Like, in real life, not in hologram. But... I think we'll see more of him.
Oh, yeah.
What his deal is.
Yeah. People thought he might be Darth Plagueis. I mean, Palpatine allegedly...
Palpatine's not the kind of guy to leave loose threads.
I mean, Plagueis wasn't he supposed to be a master of death, though, so...
I guess.
Did Palpatine poison him?
I would assume he just, like, lopped his head off. That seems to be his thing.
I kind of think that he poisoned him somehow. Steve, you watched the prequels recently. Come on.
He doesn't tell Anakin how he killed him. He just implies that he did. Because that's just what Sith do. Palpatine is a little more open with how many apprentices he had, though.
I trained Dooku, who trained a robot. This isn't going very well.
Don't worry, Doko. When he comes in, I'm going to have him spare you and say you're under mind control. You only have to pretend lightsaber battle him for a second. Oh, good.
Good.
And then he gets him in the double lightsaber thing and...
Kill him.
This is when Palpatine and I have one of our famous psychic discussions. Dude, he's going to cut my head off. Now I thought about it, and I just think this is going to look cool. Besides, you don't have a hand anymore. It's all you can do. Come on, we had a thing. That went.
Allegedly, I hear that the next one, I don't remember the name of the director, but he claims it's going to be different and stuff that we haven't seen in Star Wars yet. So I wonder if we're going through like psychological kind of stuff.
I'm worried about the last one because it's the guy from Jurassic World. And I know a lot of people want to pretend they like Jurassic World, but it doesn't make any sense.
It's space dinosaurs.
Yeah. It's really... If you like Jurassic World, I don't know why you like the original Jurassic Park, but it's not for a good movie, apparently. Such a boring... They're just bad people in the movie. There's no good characters in Jurassic World. And I think maybe because it'll be Finn, Rey, and Poe, we won't have to worry about that too much. But we'll see. That's 3 years from now.
All of a sudden, during a big space battle, or not a space battle, a battle on some planet, all of a sudden, Raph, I forgot his name.
This is the ultimate stormtrooper. We've cloned him from several other species of clone trooper. It ain't its sister. Oh no. I think we're at the point where we're just gonna start going into nonsense. So
yeah, why don't we speculations, yeah.
Yeah. Why don't we wrap it up?
That is one thing though that I'm just kind of, because you know, I really like this first one, and I'm just concerned that since they're changing up, you know, like directors and stuff, that it might
Abrams is
cause a problem.
Executive producer on all three.
Oh really?
Yeah.
So I wasn't sure what he was still doing on them.
Him and the Lucas Story Group have really tight control over these next three. So I'm not too worried about it being too wildly different. So, yeah. Oh, sorry. I have a cold today, listeners. So, I think we're going to call it there. I do not have... I'm probably going to add the end crawl with where you can find us and stuff when I edit. I just don't have the energy today, but you can find us all at the links in the show notes. Make sure to visit Steve's store, Otaku Henshin.
Which should have the brand spanking new Link Figma soon, right?
Yes.
And yeah, I need to post that. Ghoul
with a taste for the gourmet. Tissue not included. But that'll be it for this week. I want to thank everybody for listening. Thanks to Christoph for coming on. I know it's hard with our schedule, but I appreciate it. And we will see you all not next week because we're going to be moving the Wednesday updates, but the week after. I'll put something up on Friday just so there's not a big gap. But yeah, we're moving to Wednesdays, folks. So we'll see you then. Adios.